Lo que se dice que más daño me ha hecho. Es que verdad, no son yo.
¿Qué Castro le tiene miedo?
Bueno, me tiene sentenciado 3 veces por condena a muerte.
Solo una pregunta. Usted ahorita se refería al atentado al avión en Barbados. ¿Usted tuvo que ver con eso? ¿Con el avión?
No, le tengo que decirte que no. Y no es solo ese, el avión de América, explotó el, y el avión que lleva los paquetes, que lleva los paquetes de Cuba, quiero volarlo. Entonces a mí me acusan de estos aviones, estos aviones de Castro, a mí me acusan, que los dejo, no que no, que sí. En una guerra. Este país y todo el mundo, en una guerra, usted tiene que derribar los aviones del enemigo, usted tiene que destruir los submarinos del enemigo, todo lo que usted pueda. Porque así, yo considero que nosotros estamos en guerra con Castro. Y en la guerra, todo es válido.
Because it turned out that most of the people on this plane were civilians. There really is no evidence that these were very, very important high-level Cuban officials on the plane, or military officials, etc.
David to our Goliath beautifully, and we'd give him an opportunity almost on a weekly basis. We do something which allows him to put the blame on us. We're unable to deal rationally with Cuba.
After the plane bomb, America and Cuba did, for once, get talking. In 79, President Jimmy Carter even invited Castro to visit the States.
The last time Fidel Castro made this journey, it was shortly after the revolution that brought him to power. Nothing that's happened since has made the visit less of a security risk for him, and on the plane coming over, he was asked if he was wearing a bulletproof vest.
What's
up?
But there was a plot to kill Castro just after he touched down on American soil.
Tengo un chaleco moral.
I have a moral one.
Moral
vest.
Tomorrow, when he makes his speech, the United Nations itself will allow no visitors. And instead of the usual sequence of national leaders coming to the podium, Fidel Castro will have the session all to himself. A sensible precaution, since last time he was here in 1960. He went on for 4 hours and 29 minutes.
The hatred still burned in one of Castro's oldest enemies. Antonio Vesciana plotted to hide plastic explosives inside a softball and throw it at Castro's car.
Sino que tenía que ser una bomba de contacto. Cuando eso se lanzara, al tocar el carro explotaba. Y eso es una cosa de mucho riesgo. Y tiene que saber muy bien, tiene que ser un experto. Y el señor Edel Montiel había sido preparado por la CIA en el explosivo y sabía perfectamente lo que podía hacer.
But Fabian Escalante's undercover agents were already on the case.
Teníamos un dispositivo en ese momento
habían personas cercas a Antonio Veciano. Y bueno, finalmente le suministramos al FBI la información. Mire, el día tal, a tal hora, se planea este atentado contra el compañero Fidelco y pudimos desarticularlo. Es decir, fueron años muy interesantes. Y yo creo que en ese combate nosotros salimos victoriosos.
¿Y eso usted era terrorista?
En aquel tiempo sí. En aquel tiempo. Pero desde hace mucho tiempo que dejé el terrorismo. Es decir, sacrifiqué a mí, el mérito no era mío, el mérito era de mi esposa y de mis hijos, que me veían de tarde en tarde. Y cuando uno tiene la victoria todavía hay una recompensa, pero aquí no hubo recompensa.
There was another man accused of the Cuban airline bombing in 1976, though he denies it. Step forward, suspect number 6, Luis Posada Carriles. His life's ambition, to kill the communist Castro. In the 50s, Havana University trained Posada in chemistry and engineering. In the 60s, America trained him in sabotage and explosives. Writer Ad Barda met him when he was on the run.
Posada came out, an elderly man, kind of silver gray hair, real gentleman, took my bags, he had a van waiting outside, he had the gravelly crushed voice, a lot of charm, a lot of self-confidence, big, big ladies' man. He gets involved from Bay of Pigs. Bay of Pigs is the jumping off point for Luis Posada, and he had a lot of advantages because he had previously worked as an exterminator. That was the first career of Luis Posada. Something that I find curious about Luis Posada is he did his degrees in chemical engineering. So he was the one with the real background in explosives.
During his many years behind bars, he discovered a talent for acrylics. Posada's paintings sell like hot cakes in Miami, and the proceeds fund his struggle against Castro. His friend, Enrique Encinosa, and his wife help out with the sales.
What I love about this is you can see the little moss growing from the walls, and again, the shadows coming off from the insides of the castle. Luis is very good at shadows. This painting is of a street in Oriente province, and to me, it's one of the best works done by Luis Posada Carrillo. If you will observe, he has excellent depth in the street, tremendous use of shadows. You know, I think you're dealing here with a sensitive man. I know it might be hard for some people in your audience to understand that a guy who spent all his life doing war and that has been accused of almost everything by one government or the other and who has lived in hiding for so many years would be sensitive. But he is.
In 1997, 7 bombs tore apart Havana's hotels. The aim? To warn European tourists away from Cuba and bring Castro's economy to its knees. One young Italian traveler named Fabian DeSalmo was killed in the blasts. Cuba security men did catch the bomber, but it was clear he wasn't the man in charge. A year later, Posada spoke to the press and couldn't help letting slip that he was the mastermind.
Another thing that goes on the charge sheet is the bombings in Havana in 1997.
Okay, since, okay. The fact of it is that it has never been proven he did it. He has never been indicted for it, so from a strictly legal viewpoint, I personally